Hello, everybody. Nice to see you all in spite of this terrible weather outside. I guess our Colombian speakers have a rough morning today. Minus 10, okay. last year, I was very happy when I realized that the B-Sides, which is an international brand, came to the Hungarian field. So last year I decided to attend as a speaker this year. So I submitted my speech and I started to wonder what if my presentation will be chosen, and finally it was chosen. So at that point I became happy. When I visited the Hacktivity conference, after the speech of Tobias Schroeder, the comedy hacker, I started to hope that my presentation will not be the next after Tobias Schroeder, because he was goddamn funny, and to be honest, I'm goddamn boring. As I see, I'm the presenter before Tobias Schroeder, so that's life. Instead of this, I wanted to deliver a good quality presentation to you guys today about the malware persistence world. Let's begin. Sorry to bore you, but I have to start with the definition. What is persistence? As for me, this is a system modification that gives the adversary a persistent presence on the attacked or target system. So to sum up, it is something which is not good from the victim side and also not good from the defender side. But the life of the malware developers is fortunately not that easy, since it is not very easy to remain persistent while you have to remain hidden. This is good news from the defensive side. That's what we are called malware paradigm, what you can see on the slide. Unfortunately, not all the malwares build up persistence. There are some exceptions. For example, the well-known ransomwares and different kind of destructowares, they just need one perfect hit to the target system, so they won't build up persistence. This is also true for different kind of memory resident malwares. They usually infect 24/7 up and running systems, like servers, different kind of servers and ATM system, for example. So they don't need to ensure their persistent presence on the system. They just remain hidden in the memory, and the system won't be restarted. Regarding malwares with persistent mechanism, I have a concept that I would like to share with you today. From my point of view, it is easier to catch the persistent mechanism itself than to keep looking for a continuously changing binaries and hashes and signatures. I'm sure you're familiar with the thing that it is very easy to change the binary to change the hash or the signature, so it's not easy from the defensive side to keep up to date your hashes. I think if we can catch the persistent mechanism, we could realize that at least we could realize that something wrong going on in our system, or, which is much more fun, we can catch the malware itself. So, as usually, we could spare some long work days or hours just by a good tool. So we need a good tool, but where to start? I have a recommendation. My recommendation is to use the sysinternal toolset for start, which was developed by Mark Rusinovic in 1996, so goddamn old thing, but the team is still keep it updated, so it's worth using it in these days, from my point of view. I have never met with Mr. Rusinovic, but he seems to be a very talented guy. He is the author of the Windows internal books. Everyone could read his books who want to ever dive deep into the Windows internals in any reason. And I don't know if you're familiar with the thing, but he's also an author of some fiction books like Trojan Horse and Zero Days. To be honest, I have never read these books. I just wanted to share this fact as a curiosity. So anyway, there are some tools within the sysinternal tools made for detect persistent mechanism. For example, there is the autoruns with the graphical user interface you can see on the slide, and its command line brother, the autoruns C. Okay, I think that's enough about tools and theories and definitions. Let's catch some malware. I would say let's do the dirty job. My first example for today is a very nasty one, the CrossRat malware. When I prepared my presentation about a month ago, it was totally resist against the most antivirus product. When I wanted to do the screenshot from the virus total, I found that two antivirus product became capable to get it, but only two, so it's quite good ratio, as I guess, from the malware perspective. So I think it is something that works work with it. If you are not familiar with the story behind this malware, I'm glad to share with you. The CrossRat has a multi-platform capability, which means it is capable to run on Windows and macOS and Linux system as well. According to the experts of Lookout, CrossRat is believed to be developed by or for the Dark Araka group, which belongs to one of the Lebanese intelligence agencies. So to use a trendy abbreviation, I would say this is an APT. The malware is written in Java, so it is easy to reverse. I guess that could be the reason why so many articles available on the internet about the CrossRat malware. As you can see the global map, there were many victims of the CrossRat attack around the world. Fortunately, there weren't any Hungarian victims. I hope this is still valid today. And let's see what this malware could do with our system. To fit into my 40 minutes presentation, I decided to skip the live demo, but I did some screenshots beforehand when I started the malware and when I inspected the persistent method itself. All of my examples are available in my laptop, so I'm more than happy to show you after the presentation. And not to mention that I will show you some demos and the last part of my presentation. To catch the malware itself, as you see, I picked up a CrossRat, original CrossRat malware sample, and I just run it in a protected environment. I just run it with Java runtime compiler because it's a Java code. To be honest, it was harder to get the proper malware sample than to get the persistent mechanism itself, but I will show you. Let's see. I hope something visible also for you guys. After a few seconds from the starting process, the malware made it persistent, which is a very, I would say, quite simple one. You can see the MGRS file. It is run by the support of the run key from the registry. There is a description which says it belongs to Java platform, the Oracle company, and there is the path which is, seems to be legit. But if we inspect the details in the bottom of the screen, it is runs from the app.local temp directory, which is quite strange, isn't it? I think that's enough about the persistence mechanism of this malware. So let's step to the second one, which is that. Does anybody know here how could I correctly pronounce the name of this malware? Okay, I would say PZ-Chao, okay? So this PZ-Chao is a very interesting malware family because it has a cryptocurrency miner capability. I guess the developer thought that if they can't steal some valuable information from the target system, they could mine some bitcoins. What would I say, funny? Welcome to the cryptocurrency era, 2018. It was firstly discovered in South Korea last year, about July, so it's not too fresh, not too old either. Got its name from its C2 communication scheme, which was thepzchao.com, and three subdomain belongs to thepzchao.com. And the rat component of this malware is a ghost rat or something very similar to ghost rat, which is used by the Lazarus APT group, which is said to be North Korean by the Kaspersky experts. If you remember the scandal in South Korea last October, when hackers stole the blueprint of the F-15 air combat plane and a big amount of classical, highly classified military documents, for example, the so-called decapitation strike plan against Fenyang, that was the malware behind that attack. Could you imagine how happy was the South Korean military guy when they realized that their North Korean friends stole that kind of military plan? So, sorry for a second, can somebody identify the plane? Because I know nothing about air combat planes, so I hope Google gives me the right results. If you see the victims of the PC Chow attack, you could realize that it belongs to North America, Asia, Australia, the Middle East, so they avoided Europe, fortunately. Victims were part of the technological, governmental education, and the telecommunication sector. To sum up, from my perspective, it is far enough to test my persistence theory, so let's do this. After running this little bastard, the first component persistent was a Win32 shell batch file. Yes, this is much more visible. And it looks like an Adobe Flash updater, and it's run as a scheduled task from the registry. As for me, anything is related to the Adobe Flash updater is, Adobe Flash is very suspicious. I think we should completely forget it in 2018. But to sum up, we got the persistence of this really complex malware, but the persistent mechanism itself is not really complex. A few steps later, because it is a modular malware, there is also another persistent method, which belongs to the malware. And if you see, it is starts from the registry as a service with random name and random description. So the attacker wasn't too professionistic. But the publisher info seems to be right, Oracle Corporation, and the image pass is also seems to be legit. So from that point, the attacker gain higher privileges on the victim's system. I also use the Magnify tool, yeah. Do you see that string about the Monero? That's about the cryptocurrency mining function. According to the Bitdefender experts, the malware starting with killing the related Bitcoin miner scheduled task or procedures. So if they experience that the target still mining some Bitcoin, they just stop it and start it for their own. What would I say nice? From my perspective, we finished with this second malware. I don't want to analyze it. I don't want to go into deeper in this because it's not fit to my presenter time. But regards on my theory, we got its persistence. Let's see the third malware, the final one for today. This is Kofter. Kofter is a pervasive click fraud Trojan. The newest samples has fileless capability. So it is something between the memory resistant malwares and the file based malware. What I say something between, because not all the files stored in the registry. Some of the files also stored in the file system, but the essential ones are stored within the registry. So it is a little bit more protected way, because with the lower rights and with the lower knowledge, the user can't inspect the file of the malware or the basic malware analysis tools. We can't inspect all the parts of the malware. Maybe you weren't familiar with it, but this is the first generation of Kofter, which was the police ransomware. That's the picture about it. Maybe you could recall your memories in 2013. Kofter is a great example of the constantly evolving malwares, which means that the bad guys keep developing their tools year to year, building newer and newer functions. And it is also mean that the bad guy behind the malware could get enough money to maintain their development process. I'm sure that some of us sitting in the room was responsible for a long development process, for example, for a 5 years long software development process. Could you imagine how much money does it take? I mean, the bad guys had enough money from then from their Rogue business to finance the development for 5 years, which is very surprising for me. From the cryptocurrency era, as I told you before, it is, seems funny that in 2013 the bad guys begging for money, not in Bitcoin or Monero or something like this, but with an alternative paying solution. Let's see the persistent mechanism of Kofter. Not to mention that Kofter has a really interesting one from my opinion. The first step is for the malware to make an entry to a run key, which is a very simple solution, I would say. And within the run key, we can found that a specific batch file make it persistent. So under the app.local dem directory, there is a random directory name and a random file name. At this point, nothing serious, I guess. If we inspect the directory where the batch file is sitting, we can see the batch file only consists of one line with a random initialization name and the correct path for another file, which is a much more interesting one. The size is much bigger, the name is random, and the extension is random. But how the malware associate the right step with the random name and random extension file? I'm showing you. They do some trick in the registry, and that's where the tricky job starts for the Kofter malware. They just register the new class regards on the random extension name. So the malware creates an entry registry, an association to the operating system with the random extension program. And next step, it is also register a command in associated with the random extension I just showing you. So they will, at that point, the malware use the MSHTA executable file to launch JavaScript, and as you see, an ActiveX object, and so on and so on. Let's see this command in details. Yeah, I just parse it to you, make it easy to understand, and also highlighted the main topics. So what is most interesting in it, that they grab a special value from the registry, they read it from the registry, then load it to a variable, then they execute the content of the variable. So without deeper knowledge, what we can assume that something interesting sits on that variable. So the next step from the malware analyst perspective, see what is in that variable. This is. Actually, it's not true. This is only 1% of that content. If you are confused, I totally understand. But let me explain in few sentences. What you see on the screen is start with some variable filling, and it continues with a long base 64 encoded PowerShell code. within the PowerShell code, there sits a process injection payload, which injects the malware process to another one, to a system process like Rec Server 32. In my analysis, I realized that it was used. And within the process injection, they hijack the basic analysis tool. So everybody wanted to do the analysis. Can't see with the basic process inspection tools. This is something I say near to the rootkit functionality or basic rootkit functionality. So so it is something technologically good quality steps from the malware developer side. The correct content of the PowerShell scripts is not directly connected to persistence topics, so not directly connected with my presentation. I just wanted to show you that we could grab this tricky malware also with the simple autoruns tool. Okay, so there are many malwares which can be catch based on their persistence only with autoruns. So autoruns seems to be a good tool. I know it's not a rocket science, I know, and I don't want to replace AV products by autoruns. I just say it's a good tool. But how we could utilize it better? There is a great tool developed by Robin Grundberg. I hope I pronounce his name well. If you use his tool, you will be warned all time when a new unsigned file will be added to your persistent to your registry and get persistence. You will also be warned if new binaries if binaries get a new hash, it means somebody changed the content of the binary which has persistent capability in your system. If a new unsigned Microsoft file added to your system, or when a non-Microsoft file without signature added to your system. So very useful information regards on your security. And moreover, you can continuously check the persistent binaries on VirusTotal, which is, I would say, quite useful, and not to mention it's free. I also put a link to the slide, so if you want to download it, just do it, try. I think it's a good tool. But what do you think? What is my problem with this tool? Anybody? My problem is that it needs the user. From a corporate network perspective, that was the question. Maybe I asked it in the wrong way. Because in a corporate network, when we have to involve the user, that's a problem. Because as I experienced in an enterprise network, in a big network, the problem always starts at the endpoint, or I would say at the end of the endpoint where the user sits. So I can't count on users to handle right way the results of some kind of warning which contains that a new binary hash appeared. That's a funny situation when the secretary just called the malware analyst guys or the defender guys that a new binary has appeared. So it's not good for the corporate usage. That's why I developed another solution. My theory was, what if we could compare all the persistent mechanism within our network with the support of autorun? If the adversary doesn't infect all the computers within the corporate network, as usually, it could be work because we could get the odds one out only based on the differential persistent mechanism, I mean those machines which was infected. Okay, but that will be a tremendous or big amount of data. How could we manage it in a quick and easy way? As usually, with a handy tool. So I wrote a little PowerShell script. It is as simple as that. It is also not rocket science, but believe me, it is operating well. My script just read all the CSV file full of predefined directory. The values from the CSV file are collected in an associative array, with the number of occurrence. And if the occurrence is less than a predefined number, which is set by the administrator of the big network, it will show that something is correct or something is suspicious. With my script, I found some interesting and unwanted up recently, so it works great, believe me. But do a test with my script. So I would say let's find the odds one out. In my example network, there are 100 PCs, 3 different hardware generations, 2 different operating systems, 4 different user levels, and I merged all the data. I don't know if you are realized, but I just want to highlight that there is an owl between two cats. Not just because I like owls, but as I know, there are always have to be at least one picture of a cat, so I put there two. But do the test. First step is sampling. Configure the autoruns to maximize the verbosity, so we need enough information to do the comparison. And this verification have to do at least daily. My recommendation is to schedule the sampling for a lunchtime in case of load balancing reason, as I experienced the least utilized time in an office environment. I mean, from the computer's perspective, is the lunchtime. You can get this information from any kind of proxy log or firewall log. And then collect the recorded samples from the workstation to a centralized place. And then merge the data. After I merged the data from my test network, we could realize that 3 different computers, the 11, the 13, and 15, running the very dangerous calculator, and one also running the VMware application. I don't want to hide this result because it is a false positive, as you told me, thank you. Sometimes it happens. But if you have the routine to handle the false positive results, it's no problem, as I see. So we found the odds one out. Script is working, theory is working, I'm happy. If I have time, as an IC, I have 10 minutes left, I will show you some another tricks. As I know, besides, it's not a defense conference, but a hackers conference with some defensive topics. So I just want to show you some example how the malware developers could fool the autoruns application. Let me share with you probably the easiest way. I accidentally found it during the preparation phase of my presentation. If somebody register a value under the default run key with a common Microsoft application like the calculator or the MS Paint, it won't be displayed within the autoruns. I don't know what's the reason behind this. Maybe the developers of autoruns believe that it have to be a benign process if the calculator or the MS Paint running. But as for me, if you have the capability to manipulate these processes or these executables, it could be bad. A guy called Adam from Hexacorn published a funny way to fool the autoruns application. The fundamentals behind this trick is to use environmental variables. But I guess it is better if I show you in a demo. Okay, so we are logging into the machine, the test machine. We just pick the very dangerous malware, which is a PuTTY application, and then rename it to percentage username percentage, so the environmental variable of the user. Then we copy it to the Windows system directory. Yeah. After it successfully copied, we just register the persistence to the registry with the registry editor application. I just choose the easiest way as usually, so put an entry to the run key, let's call it B-sides. And you can see there is the environmental variable belongs to the username. I make a short, I mean a fast reboot. After the reboot process finished, we will see, we will realize that the very dangerous putty is running. Okay, login. Putty is running. And see the autoruns. I hope you can realize. So the autoruns displayed that something suspicious from runs from the run key, and its name is besides budapest2018.exe, not malware.exe or not the malware renamed to environmental variable. That's the trick. The second one is quite the same with another environmental variable. Are you familiar with the thing, what is the comp spec environmental variable? Does anybody know it?
CMD.
Sorry?
CMD.
Yes, the command line application. I just show it because the result is a bit more interesting than the previous one. So we do all the same things as I did before. There is a dangerous putty. We rename it to percentage comp spec percentage. Then accidentally run it. After, copy it to the Windows system directory. And make its persistence by the registry editor. Yeah. Let's call it B-sides again. And there is the comp spec percentage, I mean between two percentage. Okay, let's do a fast reboot. After the reboot, we will realize that the very dangerous putty is running. And what we will see within the autoruns, that nothing serious happened, so it hasn't highlighted anything. It's just shown that the user or somebody runs the CMD application, so the command line application, but is running. I just wanted to magnify it to you that nothing suspicious found by the autoruns application. Okay. a bit more complex way to was published by a talented malware analyst lady called Hesherazade. In this method, we could initialize our malware first with the run-dll32.exe, next with the shell32.dll, and with its shell-exec parameter, so we can run our application without showing it avoid to be displayed in autoruns. So in this case, the only thing we could realize that something ran from the run key, and this is the run-dll32.exe. If we want to see any, if we want to get to any more details, we have to inspect more. My last example, and I'm good in time, so my last example is a really tricky way based also on file associations. It was published by also Adam from Hexacorn. I wouldn't call it autorun hacking. It is just a trick. But you know, sometimes the simplest tricks hit the best. So since the trick is based on several steps, it is easier to show it in a demo. So what we do is to make banning a benign shot at the first step. So without any infection, by the normal system, And then we save the output, the log of the autoruns, to an autoruns.ern file. Then open the registry editor and make a file association key. So we are telling the system that if the user wanted to run the autoruns, it just open the autoruns application output log, so it will shown. So the B9 shot will be shown if the user runs the autorun. I just run the autoruns application, as you see, yeah, the autoruns.ern result will be shown to the user. So if we build up another persistence, it won't be shown to the user, only if he or she made a refresh on the autoruns application. I'm getting out of time, so I'm stepping forward. Thank you for your kind attention. I think that's much more than enough about me and about the persistent mechanism. I will publish my slides and my tool on the official B-Sides webpage, so feel free to contact me. Feel free to use it, and feel free to contact me next to the presentation. You could also develop further my script. Just please share with it to me.